For a while now, I've been playing with making USB-C connectorless designs, and I wanted to play with these cute 7-segment LCD displays I found on AliExpress. Mostly because I didn't know anything about driving LCDs without power chips, but also because I was curious if it was possible to turn LCDs themselves into USB touch sensors. And the answer was yes, and all of this with a ch32v003, a tiny 10-cent RISC-V microcontroller that doesn't even have native USB LCD or touch controllers. It all started when I was browsing the pages of cheap parts on AliExpress and I came across these 7-segment LCD displays. They were really tiny and really cheap, and I mean really cheap. While I spent about 50 cents each for them, they go down to about 21 cents each after shipping at quantity 100. I had to hunt around a little bit for other listings, but I found one that gave some basic data, and I decided to buy some and see what I could do with them. The ch32v003 has become my absolute favorite processor over the last 2 years, and I've used it in maybe 20 to 30 designs. One of the earlier projects was to add USB for a bitbang USB stack capable of supporting HID API for passing arbitrary data to or from the microcontroller from apps or even WebHID web pages. One of the follow-up projects was writing a driver that could fit into the 1920-byte bootloader and make it possible to program these little guys without a programmer at all through USB. This was huge because I wanted to make this little test board as small as possible and preferably without needing a programming connector. Speaking of connectors, there's a lot of people who've used USB Type-A connections without a connector, mostly because they line up to about a 1.6mm PCB's width and you can use them and you don't need a connector at all. They're used for things like USB-powered business cards, but not a lot of people have USB Type-A extension cables, so I've been increasingly curious if it was possible to do USB-C without a connector, and instead make the circuit board itself the inside part of a USB-C connector. So I set out to design these little boards where I would use the LCD to hold the USB-C cable in place and use the PCB as the paddle in USB-C connectors. I ordered the boards from JLC PCB since I really didn't want to have to solder the surface mount parts down myself. Because I wanted to make sure I didn't damage my USB-C cables, I couldn't use the normal surface finish known as Hassel. I decided to use a NIG or 25 micrometer thick gold, as this would make sure that the connecting pads wouldn't have bumps on them that could damage USB plugs. Because the boards were 0.6 millimeters thick and I had to use the Enig finish, the base setup labor cost was much higher than the normal prototyping service from JLC PCB. For only 10 boards, it was going to cost $69.52. So I decided to order 25 for $79.39 US dollars to cut down on the relative costs per unit. About 8 days later, I got my LCDs and my PCBs. The PCBs were perfect. The USB-C connection was surprisingly robust and was difficult to cross-thread within the connector. It even retained the satisfying click action when plugging it into a USB-C cable. But the LCDs, well, let's just say I understand why so many of the listings have 3-star reviews and people were complaining about the packaging. In spite of quite a few mangled pins. So far, I've had zero failures, though. I started assembling some and writing some firmware. Coincidentally, my friend Nolan, my Discord server, started playing with the passive LCD panels as well. So, with a little help, I got some of the digits to turn on and start displaying something. Surprisingly, it seemed to work best when I was just using the internal pull-up and pull-down resistors to drive the LCD, rather than driving the outputs in a push-pull or higher current configuration. I also tried flashing on the RV003 USB bootloader, and it worked the very first time. After flashing on the bootloader using the programming pins, it enumerated and I was able to flash on more firmware, and if I didn't want it to flash, I would just have to wait about 4 seconds for the bootloader to just boot directly into the user code. While for my primary dev board, I wanted to be able to use printf, debuggers, and quickly iterate, so I soldered the SWIO pin on to do all of that. But for subsequent boards, I just had to hold the programmer's pins against the programming pads long enough to get the bootloader on. Then I could flash the main firmware over USB. For my touch, USB, and LCD firmware, which is about 5 kilobytes, programming with the SWIO interface only takes about 1.5 seconds, but flashing over the USB does take a bit longer at about 5 seconds. One of the first things that I found after flashing on my LCD code was that when the USB jack was inserted, some of the LCD segments stopped working properly. It took me a lot longer than I'd like to admit to notice that this was just because the USB-C itself, the connector, was hitting some of the pins on the back of the LCD and shorting them to ground. Thankfully, my girlfriend had some UV gel nail polish, so I just dabbed some on the back and blasted it for a couple of seconds with a 375 nanometer UV LED. 375 is just what I had laying around. Other sources say 400 nanometers works well too. I don't really know. It just surprised me how quickly it cured and how effective it was at insulating the LCD while helping keep the USB-C plugs in place. Based on a diagram in NXP's AN3219 that Nolan found, the idea is that you can drive the COM pin lines at 1/2 VCC, then, one at a time, drive those lines low, and whenever you want a segment to be lit up, you maximize the voltage difference by driving the segment high. Then you flip it all around and doing the opposite, driving the COM pins high one at a time and the seg pins low when you want to light up a segment, but keeping the COM pins, when not in use, at 1/2 VCC. LCDs don't seem to care about the positive and negative, but they do seem that if you want to light up a segment, you just maximize the voltage difference. While driving the COM pins at VCC instead of 1/2 VCC kind of worked, and floating the COM pins when not in use worked a little bit better. Depending on the segments that were on or off, it changed the brightness in really weird ways, not to mention the DC bias across the digits caused some very strange effects in the LCD that at least temporarily seemed to damage it. I really needed to drive that 1/2 VCC, or about 1.6 volts, but there's no way to drive the pull-up and pull-down resistors simultaneously on the 003, which would give me exactly that. Instead, I opted just to make a small loop in assembly that would drive the selected COM pins high for an equal amount of time as low. While it's easy to make something that does this approximately in C without any assembly, it takes about the same amount of time. It's difficult to guarantee that the high and low times are exactly the same, so it was just easier to write this little loop in assembly and not have to worry about it. With this, I had proper LCD signaling set up. I was able to drive out a great pattern, and I had a little bit of time at the middle and at the end of each LCD update to do whatever I wanted. And I knew exactly what I was going to do with that little bit of extra free time. LCDs are made using ITO, or indium tin oxide coated glass, so the connections internally are conductive, same as what touch sensors and screens typically are made out of. And I thought, I wonder if I can make the LCD a big old touch button. Now, the ch32v003 doesn't have any touch hardware, but even if it did, I wouldn't be able to use it anyway because I didn't want to apply some kind of differential voltage to the LCD segments when doing the touch measurements. What I did was drive the outputs to the LCD low at the same time as starting the ADC sample read, and I mean all of the LCD outputs low. I would then apply a pull-up resistor to the COM and seg parts of the LCD all in unison. This caused the voltage to start to drift up, but all together on the LCD so that there wasn't differential voltages. The ADC's sample gate would remain open for about 375 nanoseconds, and then it would close. The voltage on the pin would be measured at that time. If no finger was present, the ground would go up rather quickly because the pull-up resistor didn't have to contend with as much capacitance. But if a finger was closer or touching the screen, that speed that the voltage would rise at would be slower because there was functionally a capacitor that was being made between the screen and the finger that needs to be charged. So now, the voltage at the time the ADC gate is closed would be lower if a finger was present. By sampling a few hundred times, also called oversampling, I was able to get a very clear picture of what the capacitance on the screen was. When oversampling, there are decaying returns. As the number of oversamples goes up, the amount of precision that you gain back is actually more like the square root of the total number of oversamples that you take. From there, I added a little bit of hysteresis to make a boundary of being pressed or unpressed, so it would remain in its current state instead of fluttering on or off. So it would have to go beyond a threshold to turn on, then to turn back off, it would have to go below another threshold, which was lower than the on threshold. Now, I had this beautiful waveform controlling an LCD and reading a touch sensor all in unison. Time to take these wonderful waveforms and absolutely throw a wrench into the mix. Because the USB is all in software, the processor interrupts the LCD and touch operations in whatever state they're in and handles receiving USB frames on the host PC. Now, there's some tiny critical sections around the little bits of code where I handle the touch, but for the LCD code, no such section is really possible. That 1/2 VCC very quickly becomes 0 or VCC. The wild part is that it has no apparent impact on the overall appearance, and the stops breaking in touch don't seem to have an impact either. It was all working. Now I have this cheap, tiny, self-contained, USB-enabled, 3-digit, 7-segment LCD with touch capabilities thing for an insanely low bill of materials. I had a lot of fun, and I learned a lot too. And I hope through this, you did too. For now, I can finally live the dream and be part of that meme. After editing the video, I had two addendums. One was that I did play with UV glue, and it worked spectacularly well, so I would recommend it for anybody. And the other one was that I'm using one of the outputs of the LCD as the reset pin, and I kept forgetting to reprogram the option bytes, so it wasn't working. So yeah, just make sure you check your option bytes when you're working with the 003. Also, wow, it's really pretty to look at these things without the backing material on. I just love clear LCDs. All of the code and designs and everything are available on the GitHub, and thanks for watching.